What is going on, everybody? Welcome to another episode of Pod Scum. I am your host, your bastard of ceremonies, Reckless Rex Ruger. And if you couldn't tell by them extremely large chompers, that, of course, is my silent sidekick, the Freddie Mercury puppet. We are back with another amazing episode of Pod Scum. I am, of course, also, if you're looking at the face and saying, where do I know you from? Wait, don't tell me. Well, I'm going to tell you. It's because I look so familiar because you're looking at the face of Diamond David Lee Roth Jr. Take a look, folks. It's undeniable. My lawyers have assured me that very soon they will prove that you are looking at the son of glam, the front man for the band, the peanut butter to your jam, adored by millions of fans. Wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. Mr. Wap-bop-a-loo-bop-a-wop, bam, bam, shazam, hot damn. Whew. I'm feeling good and no doubt looking good. God damn, that is a rock star staring back at me. Thank you, Pops. And of course, you know how I get that done. Not only the great genetics from Pops, but also right there. It's no secret. And of course, the disclaimer, as always, is you won't look this damn good because that's impossible. But you use this stuff and you get it in your life, you should look pretty good. That being said, let me start out while we're waiting for my guest to get in here. And he's the singer of a band that's really doing some amazing things, man. Fellow New Yorkers, at least as of right now, I believe they are all residing and working out of New York City. But really interesting, cool sound, man. And kudos and salutations to their promotional team because their latest single entitled Last Time is a song that when you go on Facebook, at least me, I just cannot get away from. Not only is it infectious and catchy, but it is goddamn near impossible to avoid because it is everywhere. And I guess in this day and age in the music business, man, that's not a bad thing, man. Stay relevant, stay in people's faces, stay in people's ears. So it's a great formula. My hat's off to them, man. But we'll get to more of that later, man. Let me do my obligatory promotions. Of course, make sure to like and follow Pod Scum on Facebook and make sure to like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell on this channel. This is where the cool kids come to chop it up with your boy, Rex Ruger. One of them is here right now, my guest. Let's get down to it and chop it up. Let's go. Where is Kiko? Where is Kiko? There
what
he
up,
is.
What's up, man? How you doing?
Well, first of all, man, I want to say, man, that this has got to be a pretty big deal for you, man, because if you couldn't tell by looking at me and a picture of Pops up there, you know, it's got to be pretty exciting dealing with Diamond David Lee Roth Jr.
Absolutely. Hell
okay.
Yeah.
Fair enough. Yeah. And
that's great.
And just tell me right off the bat, man, is it undeniable when you look at me?
You know, now that you say it, now I could see it.
Okay, listen, everybody that affirms it, I say the same thing to you, man. I might quote you on that, and I may subpoena you.
All right, bring it on. Yeah,
I might need you. I might need you. And I was just saying in my little preamble before you came on here, man, kudos to whoever your promotional team is, because I can't go on Facebook and not find that Last Time song. It's infectious, it's catchy, and whoever is doing your promotional or your street team or whatever, maybe it's you guys doing this, man.
Yeah, but, it's me, so yeah. Appreciate it.
Dude, hats off, man, because you know what? I think that kind of aggressive approach is almost essential in the music business
today. It absolutely is, man, and it's good to kind of have control of how you're being perceived in the world, you know?
Yeah.
Instead of just giving it to someone else and just, you know, having them deal with it. So
yeah,
it's pretty wild. Yeah.
So I usually start these things by kind of going back to the beginning, man. Was there a specific album or an artist or a song that really jump-started the music thing for you?
Metallica, I would say, is like the one band that off the bat, I was like, holy shit, what is this? I was like 7 when I discovered Metallica, and that changed my life.
Which listening to your stuff now might not be an obvious influence.
Definitely not. Cause I I was very much a metalhead only until like about, I was the age of like 16,
yeah,
17. And then I became a jazz head, and then I started playing a ton of jazz, and then just kind of started listening to a lot of Brazilian music, a lot of everything. So, yeah, I've listened to pretty much everything.
and And so for people that might not know, you know, and obviously the music industry loves to put, you know, artists in little boxes and genres, you know, is there a genre that you think you guys fit into? Because when I listen to you, I hear elements of like a band like U2, but then I hear elements of industrial and pop. Definitely. And soul. You know what I mean? You guys are kind of coming at it from a lot of different angles.
But that was always something that at first we struggled with, because everyone does want to put you in a box, whether it's going to be on a festival or it's going to be on a radio or it's going to be something like that. And at one point we just decided to say, hey man, this is who we are. Let's embrace that. Let's not sit here and, you know, try to put us in a box, ourselves in a box that we don't know what we are. So honestly, I think we're added color. That's what we are. Yeah. You know, there's elements of metal, there's elements of pop, there's elements of rock, there's elements of everything, because we listen to so many different kinds of music. But every song has a story that needs to be told. And if the sound is to tell that story is going to lean in one genre or the other, that's what we're going to go for. We're not going to like curb ourselves to try to fit into a box, you know?
And at one point though, there were four members. You guys are now a trio, correct?
Yes. Very amicable breakup. It was just during COVID. We were kind of laying low for a while, and he decided to move to Costa Rica to work with ayahuasca and shamanism. So he's still in Costa Rica. He's happy as fuck. So we still keep in touch, and we also had some creative differences, and we wanted to go in this different direction, which is what we're doing now.
Yeah. And so when the three of you guys get together to make music, man, what is the creative process like? Is it very collaborative? Does one of you guys bring the lion's share of the ideas? How does that work?
It's really different song to song. Usually someone will bring an idea, whether it's a chorus or, you know, let's say my brother, Dan, the drummer, he'll be like, hey, I got this vocal melody or these lyrics. And then I'll sit there and find the chords behind it. Sometimes Tim will bring a full-fledged song and then we'll flip it on its head. But it's very collaborative. We really are in the room together all the time. Tim does a lot of the production stuff. So a lot of those like industrial sounds. And we kind of recorded those for over like the last few years, where we just kind of sit, you know, get a trash can, bang on it, put some reverb, reverse stuff, and then make some cool new sounds. But he's really the one driving that ship. So that's it's very collaborative all the time.
And what's the dynamic like? You know, obviously things are going extremely well for you guys right now. Has the dynamic between you and working with your brother always been good? Is it more Van Halen or is it more Oasis?
Not Oasis, because we're still together.
No one's punched anybody out yet.
I sometimes we want to fucking kill each other, but we're brothers. But it's actually pretty great, man. I'm really lucky to have my brother be, you know, my best friend and a collaborator. So it's actually pretty smooth, and it's gotten more and more smooth. I think when we were a little younger, we would butt heads a little bit. And I think once you start really putting your ego out of the way and really not be like, not holding any grudges and really kind of just like serve the music, all that bullshit goes away. You know, I think so many people that fight in bands, it's just a bunch of egotistical guys. So and we're trying to keep that as far as possible to make the music the best we can, you know.
And you and your brother are originally from Brazil?
Yeah.
And so you guys were born there?
We're born, and then I moved here when I was 18, and he was 18 when he moved here. So
it's remarkable, because you guys are young guys, but no really hint of an accent at all.
So our dad's from New Orleans. So we always spoke English to him at home and Portuguese with our mom. Okay. And but it was always like this kind of like bilingual dinner table kind of thing.
And now, do you feel like the Brazilian at all, having spent a bulk of time there, do you feel like any of those South American influences, do you take any of those and bleed any of them into music? Because like, obviously you being a metalhead, like I think of somebody from Brazil, like a Max Cavalera from Sepultura.
Definitely.
You know, he did that Roots album, and he introduced a lot of tribal drums and a lot of stuff along those lines.
Definitely. So we do that a lot, and we're working on an album right now, and that's been coming up a lot. And sometimes we'll do it more subtly. A lot of the like the syncopation we'll use on some rhythms, or like even the rhythm guitar, or we'll do that. But we're also, we mentioned the industrial side, we'll layer like dozens and dozens of percussion tracks. And we'll kind of like, they'll come in and out of the song. Like a song like Disposable has a lot of that. Monolith has a lot of that, and we'll kind of just like bring it in subtle ways. Sometimes we'll do like literally sit there and record 50 layers of percussion, kind of like that Roots vibe, and layer it at times, but and then we'll try to modernize it a little bit and make it a little industrial. But the underlying rhythmic tones are very much taken from Brazilian music. It's kind of like what I listen to the most.
And where do you guys stand on like touring? Like when this album is done, you know, I noticed you've released like a string of singles. I imagine at the end of that there'll be an album. Yep. And then is the plan to go out and do touring?
So we were touring a lot. And we kind of just had to take a step back and focus on an album. We just finished our last tour was beginning this summer. And we're like, we got all these ideas. Let's put this, you know, fucking record this finally.
Yeah.
And so none of the songs you've heard yet are off this new album. We actually wrote about 20 songs, are bringing it down to 10. We just spent some time in LA with this sick producer called Anton DeLost. I'm a big fan of his, and just reached out to him on Instagram. He's like, yeah, come spend a week at my house and we'll make music. And so that was really cool. So once we're done with all this, which I'm hoping should be beginning of next year, we'll start doing the touring thing again, because I cannot wait to be back on the road. It's like,
and so as I mentioned earlier, because you guys like have a sound and you attack it from so many different angles, you know, what would be the ideal tour package? You know, is there somebody out there that you have in mind, you know, like if you could put your promoter's hand on and say, wow, a dream bill would be for Added Color to be out there with, you know what I mean? Like, because it seems like, you know, putting you on a tour package and having like a good fit would probably be a not always an easy thing to do when you're you're so diverse as you guys are.
So the way I look at it is you could find like, oh, there's bills that everyone sounds the same. And I personally never enjoyed those shows.
Yeah.
I kind of like to go to I'd rather be the outlier and be the eclectic one. Right. Dream bill would be opening for Muse. That's like we get compared to Muse a lot. And I think because they go to so many different places, but there are a few bands that, and they actually lean heavier that I think we would crush opening for, like Sleep Token, Bad Omens even. Because especially with the new work that we're putting, we're actually going a little, it's funny. I don't know if it's the state of the world, but there's a lot of heaviness in the new batch, and really throwing down hard, which I think live it's going to, and our live show is very high energy, a lot of jumping around. So tends to be more, you know, heavier bands, but there's a lot of cool young bands that I've been really into. Nova Twins is one of them.
Yeah.
Dead Poets Society is another one. They just released an album. And the producer we were working on with, he did that album, and I got really into them recently. So I think that would be a really good fit for us.
And one trend around COVID that I noticed, though, was a lot of people were putting out, and I realized people couldn't get out and tour then or whatever. So, you know, there's a lot of music being released, a lot of singles. I think it was almost, you know, the combination of the attention span of people dwindling, you know, kind of coupled with the fact that, you know, it's almost like people were almost being worried about being forgotten about or not, you know, not being remembered or relevant. So they were just kind of spitting out a lot of music. What do you think the best release format for you guys is? You know, do you like EPs? Do you like fully realized albums?
Man, I think it all depends. I love albums because I think that's like you get to tell a story. There's a concept there, right? But some songs just kind of live on their own. Last Time is an example of that. Like, I don't necessarily see that as part of an album,
right?
Because it's kind of an outlier for us. And I do think that sometimes I'd rather have a banger 5-song EP than like an album that has like 6 whatever songs and 5 bangers, you know? So I'm pretty open. And for me, it's very much depending on the project kind of thing. But in terms of like, what is the best, you know, thing for me? I think so much of our art is the live show too, you know?
Yeah.
And so that is the other big release. But when it comes to touring in general, you know, I think the music landscape has changed a lot, where before you just kind of hit the pavement and build your fan base that way.
Yeah.
And we did that for a while. We did the DIY touring, but it's so expensive. It's freaking hard.
Very.
And so, you know, the beauty of the online thing is that you could actually build a following like that and create the demand. So when you're going out, you could actually have A, more leverage with the promoters and the bookers, but B, so you could actually have your fan base, you know, and have that group of weirdos and outliers come together in a way that you wouldn't be able to just by hidden pavement, you know? So.
And so you guys do like most of the, you know, cause I noticed like a lot of the, ads for the Last Time single, are you guys out and about in New York City, you know, acting like you're about to do like a public service announcement, and then boom, one of you guys knocks over the other guy, and then suddenly the song comes on, or like all the promotional stuff, you know, do you have label support? Do you have help, or are you guys strictly, really doing everything on your own?
It's all on our own, man. And this last year has been really cool. We've sold a few thousand physical CDs, which has been really cool, just on our own. A lot of online marketing. I did a pretty big deep dive for a few years on how to work that.
Yeah.
And it's been really cool, you know, because we're really reaching new people that we wouldn't have otherwise. But yeah, we're doing it on our own. I wish we had more help, but it's also one of those things, we've worked with other people and we were always so much more passionate about it. So until we find the right team, we're going to keep it in house. You know, it has to be someone who could blow our minds and like really elevate us, you know.
Well, I talked to a lot of old school musicians on here, and you know, some of them from the metal world or the hard rock world or whatever, and some of them have kind of come into the age of technology kind of kicking and screaming, but they realize though that you know that technology, whether we want it to be here or not, you know, it's not 1980 or the 1990s anymore. You kind of got to have like the social media profile, and you kind of got to be doing the self-promotion, and you got to be doing, you know, obviously we're doing a podcast right now, but you got to be out there. You got to have a presence.
Absolutely. I mean, it's what you said. Look, it's here. You can bitch about it, or you could see it as something awesome. You know, it's pretty great that I could put on videos, like you said, and look, we're here because of it, right?
Right, right.
So I put on a video and it's reaching thousands of people out there. You know, that's something that you didn't have before. You didn't have that control. So I think, do I think there's a lot of problems with social media? Do I think it's actually affecting art negatively in a lot of ways? Yeah.
Yeah.
But if you're making music that you care about, your audience is there. And also it's a really cool way to find out if something's resonating or not, you know?
Yeah.
Like that song Disposable we did, we wrote that. We're like, you know, let's not, you know, this is going to be a deep cut. No one's going to give a crap about this one. It's a weird song. And it's actually the one that's resonated probably the most this year with a lot of young, new people, you know?
Yeah.
I think it's because the opening lines are, I'm your slave, I'm your whore. So I think that on social media, people are like, what the hell?
Yeah. But,
but you know, I'm kind of trying to look at it and just be more optimistic about it and kind of use the tools that are available to us, you know?
Now on Instagram, your tag is music for lunatics. Now, what do you mean by that?
For me, a lunatic is just someone who, thinks for themselves and is different. I think in general in society, people who are considered crazy are just people who are steering from the norm.
Right.
And added color is about adding your color to a black and white world, about celebrating your individuality. So for me, a lunatic is anybody who is themselves unapologetically, thinks for themselves. And fuck it, if you're crazy, you're free. You are who you are. And that's what it means to me. And it's based off of a song we wrote called Lunatic. It was on one of our first EPs. And, you know, it's like, I'm a lunatic, but I found a world where I'm free in my head. And that kind of became anthemic to us, you know, what it is to be a lunatic.
Yeah. So a couple subjective questions, man. So for you, and of course, you know, this is strictly your opinion, but who would be your Mount Rushmore of all time musical artists?
Holy shit.
You're four.
How far back can I go?
As far back as you want. Like, obviously, I'm not meaning who you think the greatest four artists are, just for you specifically, the four that mean the most to you.
Man, that's a hard one. Weirdly enough, Beethoven is up there for me. Just
because that guy
was talking about a lunatic, you know, even the way he worked, the way he orchestrated things, were like breaking all the rules, but it just was awesome.
Yeah. And lopping off his ear is pretty lunatic. It's pretty, that's lunatic.
Exactly. still old for me, Django Reinhardt, guitar player from the French guitar player. Guy was able to like shred faster than anybody with two fingers, you know.
Yeah.
Like, what the hell?
Incredible.
It's insane. Let me think. Man, this is a really hard one. And I'm gonna stick to older bands because I do think that I think Pink Floyd is a band that for me. It was
I can hear that in your music, sure.
So yeah, so that's for me. It's I always joke that's like, if someone could say what kind of music you make, I'm like, if Pink Floyd took Molly instead of acid, and I was talking about that to my brother yesterday. I was like, man, you know, you hear Zeppelin, love Zeppelin, but I'm like, you could hear their influences. And I'm like, where the hell did Pink Floyd come from? You know,
right.
Like it's from some acid trip that opened a new universe or something. So they have to be there. And God, the fourth has to be Brazilian. But there's so many. I I think maybe Baden Powell.
Okay.
He's a Brazilian guitar player.
Now that's an eclectic Mount Rushmore. That's an eclectic Mount
it
Rushmore.
It is. And it's kind of crazy because there's so many more that I would love to quote, but
obviously we got to get up on the mountain and chisel off an ear for Beethoven, but
exactly,
I mean,
that, exactly. Yeah. But yeah, I just think those are like so fundamental for me in music, you know.
And is it daunting right now though, being like a young musician? Because even older guys who I have on here, and I deal with a lot of hard rock and metal guys. I'm pretty much open to having anybody on here and having a great conversation with anybody from any genre. But a lot of established artists that have come on here. Still out there doing it, and you do hear now more than ever, you know, people are doing it because they love it. You know, you always hear that saying, "Oh, I do this because I love it." But now it is really hard, like unless you're Taylor Swift or you're way up at the top of the food chain, you know, to really be super profitable, man. Was there any point in time when you guys kind of being in the embryonic stage and just getting going as a band, has there ever been any frustration or a sentiment of like, you know, throwing in the towel or frustration of any kind?
Oh man, every day. but never throwing in the towel, because I think that you have to do this not because you like it or love it, it's because you need to.
Yeah.
You know, it's like the same thing as drinking water or eating your food. For me, it's like I can't imagine a life without this. So that's, for me, it's almost like a necessity for my life. But yeah, man, it's there's so many times I'm like, shit, was I born in the wrong era, right? Like, but I do think that people, that's a negative attitude to have, and I've noticed that there are ways to make profit as an independent artist. It's just a very different kind of path you have to take, and you have to really take control over as much of your assets. You know, it's not just like post on social media, you know, through mailing marketing, you know, also negotiating good guarantees and whatnot, getting around the right people, you know. So, but it's a struggle. It's hard as hell, but
is it easier to be a DIY band, or if a label came along and found your music amazing, they want to sign you, all that stuff, would you still prefer to be on your own? Because I do hear a lot of people say, you know, sometimes a label can do more harm or good. There's a lot of people that are happy that the labels have gone belly up and that streaming is here. Yeah. I don't know how much they do. I'm not a musician myself. I don't know how much, you know, they do nowadays for a young band. What's your feeling on that?
I think it all depends on the deal and the label. Like, I have friends who are signed and they're like, okay, I got $1,000 for my record. I'm like, what the hell is that going to do?
Yeah. Are they any better off than you necessarily?
No, you know, they're not, you know, and I know, because also I see how much I'm generating versus them. And I'm like, so if your label's not going to generate and just take a cut, it's not worth it. But absolutely, if the right label that has the right culture that I care about and who could open the doors, because that's the thing, it's still, music industry is still a little club, right? And people with influence could open doors for you and connections and all that stuff. So, and money, right? And front all that.
That's always nice.
Yeah, so like that's definitely something that I would love if it was the right deal. You know, I've had offers for deals I just didn't think were that interesting to me, because I'm like, what are you truly bringing to the table? You know, it's like we're getting in bed together, like
right. And I know a lot of times, man, you know, artists want to just be the artist and not deal with the business side. You know, there's three guys in your band. Are you the guy that kind of spearheads all the business stuff?
We do a lot everything together. Like, we have meetings every week about this stuff. We all bring different things to the table. I tend to just do more of the, like, you know, actually running ads and social media, all that stuff.
Light work. Yeah.
Yeah. But honestly, we all do, you know, like my brother does a lot of the video editing, you know, also like building all these landing pages. And, you know, Tim does a lot of the accounting and a lot of, so we do a lot together, you know.
Yeah.
And because we're shipping out so many CDs every week these days, it has to be a joint effort, you know.
Is there more of a pressure? Was there a slack or like like anything that affected the sound when you guys went from a four piece down to a trio? Was there anything that anybody had to kind of like step up and take more of a role in?
No, you know, it's interesting. One of the main things that we wanted to do was go more industrial, especially with the bass. Like, I love bass guitar and I actually record bass guitar in our songs, but there's something about an electronic bass or like a synth bass that you could just go so low and it feels like, you know,
yeah,
it just envelops the whole world. And I think that's such an interesting thing. So it actually kind of just funneled or shifted our musical composition in a way that's a lot more liberating, because before I was like, oh, we got four guys, what's each guy going to play? But now we're really embracing the whole computer thing with the rock band thing. So it's actually pretty freeing, because it's like, why not layer a bass and five synths on each other? Who gives a shit?
You know, like, all bets are kind of off nowadays. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, yeah, it's like, you don't have to be the traditional, okay, you're the guitarist, you're the bassist, you're the drummer. You know what I mean? And so what do you do other than sing? Do you play an instrument as well, for people that don't know?
I play guitar, bass, and piano, and percussion. So if you go to our live show, you'll notice, like, I'll play percussion, go back to the guitar, things like that.
Okay.
And that's the thing in the band too. We all, like, you know, we're in the studio passing instruments around each other, you know. We all write, like, my brother's a drummer, writes some guitar riffs, I write some drum riffs. And it's funny, because it's like, when I'll write a drum riff, you know, I'll program it and he'll play it. I'm like, he's like, God damn it, this is fucking weird. Like, this is obviously a guitar player wrote this.
I can't replicate this.
No, he always pulls it off. I don't know how he does it. And he's harmonizing while he's doing it. It's nuts.
Now, obviously, talking to a lot of musicians on here, you know, we talked about the band's creative process, but what about for you individually, like, as the front man, as somebody that writes lyrics? You know, I hear a lot of guys on here say they get a lot of ideas. Oddly enough, I hear a lot of guys say in the car or at their day job, they'll get sparks of creativity and they're writing something down or humming something into a phone. You got the creative types who kind of sequester themselves away. I'm going into a room and I'm going to write. Like, what's the approach like for you?
So we all do write lyrics and vocals because we all sing too, but it's interesting. Sometimes we will go on these, like, retreats, like, we'll go in the woods for a week and just set up a band in, like, a cabin that our friend has, and take a bunch of fun stuff and just kind of write music for a week. And then that kind of releases, kind of creates a different kind of music. Sometimes ideas do just come in the shower, or, like, and I'm late a lot of times because of that, because I'm like, okay, I gotta, like, register this idea
somewhere. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, and sometimes, like, last time I woke up hungover and wrote those lyrics, because it's actually about a love affair, toxic relationship, but it's inspired by alcohol abuse, right? And drug abuse. So it was kind of like, I looked in the mirror at one point and I was like, holy shit, like, and those lyrics just kind of came out. So it is kind of like replicating the real things in my life. And sometimes I do make the space for it, you know. Sometimes I'll pick up a guitar and so I'm gonna see what's gonna happen, you know. Like, I love playing Brazilian classical guitar, and sometimes I'll write a, like, I'm writing, like, a classical guitar piece and I'm like, wait a minute, this would be a really cool melody with these chords, and then we turn it into a rock song, you know. The process varies a lot.
So are you, like, a pen and paper kind of guy, or are you like, I've got to get to my cell phone to, you know, to jot this down?
Oh, that's funny. Both, mostly cell phone guy. You know, sometimes I'll be at a bar with friends and I'll wake up the next day and there's a voicemail that's like, you know, and you're trying to hear what the hell, what the fuck did I say? And there's, like, people talking to
Matt. Out, everybody. I'm trying to
shut off the music. So a lot of that happens, but sometimes I am a, like, sit down and, you know, I used to work, I went to school for music too and writing for some orchestra stuff. So I did, sometimes I do the pen and paper kind of thing. So, well, I almost just dropped it. So I do the pen and paper, and sometimes it's just like, I'm out in the street, this is what I got, it's a voice memo.
And then what about the behind the scenes stuff? Like, are you guys very proficient, like, with the behind the scenes stuff? Like, I know you said you went out and you worked with a producer and you went out and spent some time with them, man. But are you guys, like, adept at, like, producing your own music, or do you have any interest in learning to do that?
Yeah, we do. So we do all of it usually. This is the first time we worked with an outside producer. We were really, I don't know how familiar you are with metal, but do you know a band called Gojira?
Yeah, so French band. Yeah.
So they have a studio in Brooklyn, and we ended up becoming friends with them and actually helped run their studio.
Oh, they're
and
great.
They're front of house, who's also the guy who mixed that album Magma. He does all of our mixing, and he's kind of like our fourth member these days. Like, we're, you know, really close. So he's, you know, really opened up a lot of that world for us. But we actually have a production studio. We were hired to write music for a game for a few years as a band, which was a really fun job. So that helped fund a lot of our project. And when we were, like, writing and getting started there. So we do a lot of production in house. Like, we have a production studio where we do pretty much everything.
Yeah, like you'll see when I send you like that, and when we get done here, like I'll send you like the playlist for the past episodes. It's mostly metal guys in like, you know, thrash metal, death metal, extreme metal. You know what I mean? You know, I find that they're always receptive to doing these, and it's not that I don't want to reach out and find guys in other genres, man. But they're always like, first of all, I mean, you know, from being a guy who obviously was a metalhead, though, man, it's one of the best communities ever. You know what I mean?
They're always
receptive to coming on and chopping it up with you and bullshitting and promoting their stuff, or even if they've had a long career and they don't have anything extremely current, they're still just to come on and just chop it up in general.
Absolutely. I mean, it's also a community of music lovers, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, and real music lovers, not just like, oh, I like those lyrics. Like a lot of them are, you know, even the listeners tend to be musicians or have played at some point. So I think it's a really amazing community because of that. And it's funny, man, we always find ourselves around metalheads, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that speaks to where our influences come from, because I mean, I'm here right now. You're like, oh, I liked Last Time, which is not a metal song, but our music has this dark quality to it that I think,
right,
you know, if I could, my dream is to be every metalhead's guilty pleasure, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. That's a good way to look at it though. But I think though, man, that, now, because you've got such a history with metal, and it sounds like you certainly know your metal. When I was preparing my notes here, I went on this, you know, to see if there was any other interviews of you guys on YouTube. I saw you guys in a couple other interviews talking about metal. Do you think that will eventually shape the sound? Like, where do you see the sound of Added Color progressing to? Not that you'll morph into a full-on metal band, but do you see yourself getting heavier? Do you see yourself getting poppier? Like, where do you see the band going? Or have you not even really given that much thought to that?
No, we have, because, you know, we're working on an album right now, and that's something we talked about. And in the next batch, there's going to be a lot more songs with like bangers and more energies and like more energy and like actually crazier drum riffs. So there is an element that's getting heavier. Some songs even proggier, but
yeah,
overall it's just going to keep getting darker. And there's this element, I think, in our music that's almost like a sensual darkness, you know,
an erotic darkness. I was going to say that too. Yeah.
It's very, you know, almost drawn from a little bit of goth BDSM kind of world.
Yeah.
But in a very different way, not like, you know,
50 Shades of Gray type shit here.
Exactly. Not that shit. Not the one for like housewives to feel like they're getting deep. Like,
you guys gonna be the soundtrack for the next 50 Shades of Gray movie.
only if it's the B version that's actually dirty, not this fucking housewife shit, you know? I want the R-rated one, not the PG.
Yeah, but I like that direction though, man, because like for the longest time when I was young, man, you know, me and my friends, and I'm talking like I'm 51 years old. I'm talking about 14, 15 years old. You know what I mean? You start to equate heavy with like, all right, you know what I mean? We get into the 80s hair metal, and then you start to say, okay, what's next? You start to define punk and thrash, and then all of a sudden you're bringing deicide albums and you're going heavier, and you equate heavy with just indecipherable lyrics and growling and blast beats. But then as I get older, I start to realize that heavy means a completely different thing. Like I listen to a band like Crowbar, slow, thick, chugging riffs. But every time I see these heaviest bands in the world, I see Crowbar winning the title all the time. Or like I listen to a band like an industrial band like Skinny Puppy. Extremely fucking dark and heavy, but just not in the way that I thought of heavy back in the day. I was just equated heavy, like I said, into like, you know, growling beats and, you know, blast beats and growling lyrics and scary. But, you know, heavy takes on a different meaning. You know what I mean? Like your music in its own way is heavy.
Definitely. I mean, I think Randy Blythe said it's like, it's not how heavy you hit the snare, you know, that makes your band heavy.
Yeah.
It's like subject matter and emotion, you know, like
exactly,
for example, like, you know, Dragon Force is an example of a metal band that I don't consider a heavy band, you know,
right,
because it's fun, you know, it's metal and the riffs are heavy, but it's not emotionally like, you know, heavy, for example. And that was just one of many examples, but so yeah, I think heaviness is something I've always been drawn to, and kind of like this darkness, I think it's almost therapeutic to go through that, to come out on the other side, you know, really acknowledge those depths, because, you know, we all have crazy thoughts. We all have all these things. So I think going all the way with it makes you more peaceful. And it's also why metalheads tend to be the nicest people, right? Because they let it out, they go through it, and then they, you know,
Yeah.
So
a couple years ago, me and my wife went to see the Irish singer Hozier in concert.
Oh,
and I'll tell you what, even that is dark and beautiful and heavy in its own way. I was sitting there watching him live and then even listening to the albums, and I think, wow, he's dealing with topics of the Catholic Church and religion and all these dark, you know, some of them taboo topics or whatever, but it's heavy.
Yeah, I mean, especially, you know, if I'm not mistaken, that song Take Me to Church is about being a gay man identifying with all this indoctrination. Yeah. That's heavy as fuck.
Yeah.
You know, like, it's much heavier than, like, in my opinion, than, like, some of the, like, mythological things that metal bands do, you know? I'm not saying you have to be heavy to be cool, but, yeah, I think Hozier could be heavier than a lot of bands,
And I think that makes it heavier when it's grounded in reality, too, because you're like, wow, this is a real, real issue, like a really hot-button issue out there, man, that he's dealing with, man. That makes it heavier, like you said, than dealing with, like, you know, wizards and dragons
exactly.
and heavy metal bands to write about that's not really steeped in reality, you know?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, and I really like that you have that open mind, man. And I think that that's happening in general. I think that metalheads were the worst gatekeepers ever for so long.
They were. I've told the story on here many times where, like, I used to feel like when I was young, like, if you had the back patch and you wore the metal shirts, but you would be ostracized, or in my era, you'd be labeled the dreaded poser if anybody found out behind closed doors that you weren't flying the metal flag all the time. You know what
exactly.
I mean?
Like,
you know, exactly. Like you said earlier about added color being a metalhead's dirty little secret. You couldn't have that back in the day when I was growing up. You know what I mean? Like, you'd be drummed out of the metal community and you'd feel like, you know, shit, I'm not being fully accepted here. You know, now definitely. I think it's cooler to have an eclectic taste, and all those walls have kind of come down, and you can just tell people, look, I like death metal, but behind closed doors, I'll listen to, you know, something the complete opposite, you know?
Definitely, man. And I think that gatekeeping is so, so lame. Stupid, and it does nothing. It's what's destroyed a lot of the metal community, in my opinion, because we were all mainstream at one point, you know. Metal became mainstream at one point. And what happens is you try to preserve it so much that you keep quoting the old guys, right? And you don't let new bands flourish. Like pop music, there, you know, I was looking at the Grammy nominations today, you know, because Gojira just got Grammy nominated. And so I was like, oh, let's see who else did. And, you know, you go to the rock and metal, and it's like best performance, Metallica. Like, come on, man. Like, look, I love Metallica, one of my favorite bands in the world. But you can tell me that this new performance is everyone's hyped on it? No, it's just because it's almost political. Judas Priest. Like, it's 2024. There's a lot of young guys. And I'm also happy to see Knocked Loose in their spirit box, you know. And it just, you gotta open up the door.
It seems like reputation is getting these guys their nominations.
Yeah. And, you know, it happened to jazz, it happened to classical music. You know, every movement that tries to preserve itself too much dies in the end. And I'm glad to see metal is now on the up and up again, because I think the mindset has shifted a little bit. You know, there's a ton of cool metal bands out there, and, you know, and genres are almost irrelevant these days, but so it's cool. Like, you know, Spirit Box is an example. There's some like pop choruses and then some insane breakdowns. Sleep Token also does that. You know, you're able to just like, sometimes I feel like I'm the Legend of Zelda. All of a sudden I'm like listening to trap and then I was just gents. And like, oh, that's awesome. You know?
Now, another subjective one. If I were to take you, Kiko, and drop you on a desert island and you can only take one album, what's the desert island album?
Oof. You're going to have to give me a second here.
I never said this was going to be easy, Kiko.
Yeah. I mean, given it's going to be on a desert island, I might just like want some good vibes music.
Yeah, you probably would. I mean, I guess essentially I tell everybody this, you know, you certainly want something that's going to cover, you know, all the gamut of emotions. And essentially, I guess this is going to be the soundtrack to your fucking death, which is, you know.
Yeah. Also pretty epic.
That's heavy. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, it's funny, man. That's a really hard one for me. And not to go back, but it might be like Animals by Floyd.
Yeah.
I just think it's one of the best albums, or even Dark Side of the Moon, but I think the Animals. I've just been on a very big Floyd kick again lately.
Yeah.
I can hear
it bleed into your music, though. You know?
Yeah. Actually, harmonically, we do a lot of the same things. It's a huge reference for me. And I have a ton of their records. So I put them on vinyl and just kind of like trip out.
And so not that I can't get on Facebook and find you guys. You know, I'm obviously following you guys, man. So it's on my timeline. You know, it knows my algorithm or whatever. But for people that want to find out more what you do, man, what's the best way to find you guys? Is there a website? Is finding you guys on Facebook, Instagram? Where's the best place?
I would say Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, we're always on those, but it's all at Added Color. Yeah. American spelling, not the British one of color.
Yeah.
But
C-O-L-O-R for people that exactly. might be cracking their heads right now that might not even know that there even is a British fucking spelling.
No, you are.
Yeah. No, you are.
Yeah. So it's at Added Color, DM us. I run our social media. I love chatting with new people.
Yeah.
We recently started one of the broadcast channels on Instagram, and we'll throw in like some behind the scenes stuff there. And then if you go to our website, eclectic.com, you could sign up for our mailing list and get some exclusive content through that too.
Yeah.
And that's been a really cool thing, man. We've really, not even 6 months ago, we had like 90 email subscribers, and now we're like 1500,
That's right.
And which is not like huge, just going to keep growing, but it's really cool to have all these people that we get to like communicate with.
I feel the same way, because I've been at this podcast for a long time, and now everybody with a computer and a microphone is a goddamn podcaster. You know what I mean? So there's certainly plenty of competition out there. And I, by no means, when I reach out to people, you know, fucking say, hey, if you come on my podcast, you know, your band is going to be fucking huge because of it. You know what I mean? Like, you know, it's been grassroots. You know what I mean? I've been building it slow. The subscribers trickle in a little bit at a time. You know what I mean? Every episode, we might have dozens of views, might have hundreds of views, might have thousands of views. You know, you just never really know. It's a complete crapshoot, man. But I just like the amazing conversations with like artists. You know, I always tell people on here that I don't just pull their name out of a hat. Usually they've come on my radar for some reason. I like what they do. I respect their talents. You know what I mean? Like I've been a longtime fan of some of the people, you know?
Yeah, that's awesome, man. And honestly, it's like people like you are so important for a scene and a community and getting music out there. You know, like I'm every time someone calls me to do one of these things, I'm like honored that
the music
that I'm writing is resonating, that you're interested in talking to me about it.
Well, because the big outlets are always going to be able to secure the I'm not rollingstone.com, so I just can't reach out and say, hey, I'm going to have James Hetfield on fucking tomorrow. You know what I mean? Like I don't have that kind of fucking reach or whatever, but I don't fucking think that people that aren't on that level are any more or less fucking important, or not making as important and relevant of music. You know what I mean? Like, more than likely, man, like your album that you put out will be 1,000 times more interesting than anything Metallica's done in the last fucking 20 years. You know what I mean? And I say that as a huge Metallica fan. I love them. Going to see them next year. Probably one of my all-time favorite bands, man. But a lot of it, though, man, gets to the point where it's like, you know, they're just kind of standing on pageantry, and you know what you're going to get with a Metallica album.
Definitely.
You know what I mean? It's not necessarily going to, you know, challenge you or energize you or necessarily even like excite you if you've been listening to them for a long time, you know?
Yeah, man. And it's so hard to find artists that could actually do that. And it's funny you say that. Yesterday, I was listening to Willie Nelson's new album.
Yeah.
The guy's 91 years old, man.
Crazy.
Put out
I know.
This album. And one of the, I was like almost tearing up listening to one of the songs, you know? Yeah. It's like, so some people could do that. They're always, you know, telling new stories, but
yeah,
I agree with it. It's pretty rare. So, you know, make some room for the young guys, you know.
Are there any bands out there right now, man? Like when you listen to music from a fan standpoint, man, do you tend to fall back on old favorites? Because for a while I found myself being that stodgy old fuck that would be like puttering around the house and say, all right, I'm going to listen to some music while I'm cleaning or whatever. And I would fall back on my old favorites. Like doing the podcast has really helped me like, well, you go to the streaming platforms and say, all right, let me follow the algorithm. You know, if it says that I like this artist, maybe I might like this artist. Let me go explore it and try to broaden my horizons a little bit. And it has opened up a plethora of new guests. And I do find it exciting to give a platform to the bands that are on the come up. But what's your listening trend, though? Are you able to find stuff out there that excites you?
Yeah.
You know, like new music?
So for a while, I was, like you're saying, I was always falling back to the old stuff, but I've been really excited that I'm listening to mainly new music these days.
Yeah.
I really like the new Bad Omens record. I think it's sick. I'm really into the Dead Poets Society. I like, this album came out a few years ago, but a Nothing But Thieves record that they did.
Yeah.
Broken Machine. Love that record.
Yeah.
I'm kind of into some of what Poppy is doing, which is kind of crazy. You know, but I think she's awesome. Spirit Box, Nova Twins, if you haven't checked them out, I'm really into them. This new Dead Poets Society record is really sick. It's kind of one of my new favorite records right now, and I listen to it start to finish multiple times a week. So it's called Fish, I forgot what it's called, but it's blue. And for
people that might not know, what genre of music is that?
It's definitely in the rock world.
Yeah.
But it's kind of alternative rock, and I think they were Berkeley Cats, but they play fretless guitars. So there's a lot of these like all the basses and the guitars are fretless. So there's a lot of these like kind of riffs
And hey, what about the Nouveau Twins? Is that what you said their name was?
Nova Twins. Those are Nova two British women who are. I went to their show here. It was like a tiny show, and you know they've opened for Rage Against the Machine, Muse. They're like doing really cool stuff, and it's almost like, oh man, it's so weird. It's like it's heavy, kind of industrial, but there's an element that's really poppy, but kind of rage, kind of industrial, kind of metal. It's really hard to explain, but it's dirty. It's nasty.
Yeah.
Dude, it's
like, it's like you need a shower afterwards.
Definitely. And they're badass, man. And they're young as hell, and they're just crushing it. And it's really cool to see, you know, someone they're like in their 20s and they're killing it right now. So.
Yeah. Well, I love what you guys do, man. I certainly don't want to stand it in the way of art being made. Like, I know you were kind enough to give me some time. I know you said you guys were in the studio today, so I certainly want to let you get back to it, man. But I just want to say, man, that I know sometimes for young artists out there, it feels like an uphill battle. Is my art reaching people or whatever, man? But it is, though, man. It's finding people out here, man. I really love and applaud what you guys are doing, man. And that's coming from a guy who primarily listens to a lot of hard rock and metal, although I do have a pretty eclectic taste. I do try to branch out and listen to a lot of different things. I'm the biggest Prince fan in the world. He's my ultimate hero, man. I mean, he's a god to me. He's literally – I had an interview the other day with the drummer from the Fun Loving Criminals, and he put it the best. He said he's the 20th century Mozart. And I'm like, wow.
Straight up.
That's impactful. That's impactful to me, man. Yeah. You know, I mean, like a guy that played all those instruments, he could take your instrument, play it better than you, and hand it back to you. You know what I mean? Like, I mean, on those first 3-4 albums, he played everything. And at 17 years old, he stood his ground and said, fuck that. I'm producing my own albums too. I don't want the guy from Earth, Wind, and Fire or whoever the fuck you got to produce me. I'm doing it, you know?
Yeah. No,
a big set of balls on him, dude, man, and a real fucking genius, man, in my mind.
Amazing. I mean, undeniable. And really appreciate the kind words, man. Really, it is an honor to be here, and really happy the music found you. You know,
I appreciate
that you reached out.
Yeah, and we're in touch now, man, so let's stay in touch, man. And when you got stuff cooking, I'd love to have you back on and chop it up about it, man.
Yeah, man. And one thing we're going to do before dropping the album, we just did an acoustic kind of version of that song, Disposable.
Yeah.
We're going to drop that probably, it's getting mixed now. We're probably going to release it before the end of the year, but it's kind of like a orchestral, acoustic, weird version of the song. So I'll send that your way.
I like that you guys. I like that you guys aren't afraid like to be constrained. I think I heard a great interview before I let you go when Metallica was in the studio doing an interview with Howard Stern, and he did ask the band, you know, a couple times you put out albums where maybe the fans checked out a little bit or said, what the hell is Metallica doing an album with Lou Reed or doing an album with an orchestra or whatever? And Lars fucking said it best. He's like, you know what? I think once in a while, man, it's good to challenge the fucking fans. You know what I mean? 100%. Like, you challenge them and not worry about, you know what I mean, that they're pushing back a little bit. You know, push them back a little bit too. You know what I mean? Keep them on their heels a little bit and say, hey, this is what we're doing. You know, either you're with us or, you know, you're rowing in the same direction and you're a real fan, or, you know, I think sometimes people just get into that state where they're just like, just keep making Master of Puppets over and over again. You know what I mean?
Like, it's like, look, it's a great song, but it's, you know, 40-something years old.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, and I think that's awesome. I think you have to not only challenge the fans, you have to challenge yourself. And if you're making music thinking about the listener, it's not genuine music, you know?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
If you like my first record, but don't like my second, the first record's always going to be there. You can always go back to that.
Right.
But
right.
Like, What am I going to do? Just sit there and try to replicate that? I'm going to become a cover of myself.
Right. And that's not exciting for you either, you know?
No. And it's going to make bad art, you know?
Yeah. But I appreciate this, man. Stay in touch, man. We'll definitely do this again. I really had a blast, man. It was great talking to
you,
man.
You too, my friend.
Thank you so much, Kiko. Yep. Take care, buddy. Later. There he goes, folks. That is Kiko Freiberg, the singer, and sounds like plays a little bit of goddamn everything, man. Listen, man, to my metal heads out there, man, and the people that are that like their music heavy, man, I know that's what you've come to expect. You come here a lot, and those are the interviews that I give you, man, but do check out this band, Added Color, and as he said, C-O-L-O-R. Does anybody spell it with a U anymore, for fuck's sake? But I'm glad he pointed that out, though. Not the fucking King's English. We're not going old English style here, man. Added Color, C-O-L-O-R. They're now in New York City by way of Sao Paulo, Brazil, man. Very interesting sound. I can't quite put a finger on exactly. Well, I can. I mean, they're coming at you from a lot of different angles, as I said. Certainly lots of hints of industrial, alternative pop music, some soul, some R&B, some indie, definitely some rock, some very heavy atmospheric moody elements, man. As he said, man, they might be, if you're a metalhead, they will turn into your guilty pleasure, man. Because as I said in the interview, don't always think so close-minded about what's heavy, man. What these guys doing is very heavy, sensual, erotic. It's really good. I encourage people to go sink their teeth into Added Color. Their latest single is called Last Time, which I defy you to go on and listen to it and not have it fucking get its hooks into you, man. They're KIKO, amazing with the marketing. If you go on and you like or follow Added Color, they're very, I don't want to say aggressive because that might sound off-putting, man, but they're certainly very proactive with the way they promote themselves, which is, you know, hats off to them, man. You know what I mean? You might say, oh, Jesus Christ already. Come on, man. How many times do we got it? But you know what? It's a dog-eat-dog world out there right now in the music business, and these guys are trying to fucking make a goddamn living, man, so they're promoting the hell out of themselves, and I, for one, fucking applaud the hell out of them for it, man. They're getting the music, they're getting the videos in your fucking face and in your ears, and more importantly, stuck in your fucking brains. And catchy shit, man. Heavy but catchy, which is a recipe that a lot of people would love to be able to fucking be able to harness, but oftentimes cannot. These guys are a trio of phenomenal musicians, man. KIKO, his brother, and another member, and they are able to do that. They are able to bring the heavy, but bring the catchy, and really get a hook stuck inside your head, man, but also really fucking, you know, really have that sense of I'm listening to something heavy here wash over you. So I applaud the hell out of what they do, man. I'm a fucking fan, man. I fucking love what they do. So I implore you guys to go check out Added Color, and I think you'll really dig what they do, man. And I really appreciate they're in the studio now making music, man. KIKO was kind enough to make me some time, man. We've been talking back and forth, man. So that is KIKO Freiberg from Added Color. Do yourself a favor. Check them out, man. I can't say enough, man. Rexx Ruger approved. If that means nothing to you, or if that means a seal of approval, then I'm going to go check them out, man, which I hope it does, man. But I hope you'll come back to me and say, Rexx, thanks for hipping me to these guys, man. Fucking, I dig it. Because I know I dig it. So that being said, man, let me give myself one more fucking look here. Jesus Christ. Boy, am I a fucking rock star, man. Jesus. And of course, I got Pops to fucking thank up there, man. The great Diamond David Lee Roth Jr. right here, man. And after a fucking 45-minute interview, 45 minutes plus, still fucking got the rock star looks. Look how well I fucking held up, man. I mean, come on, man. Jesus Christ, man. I can't toot my own horn enough, and I can't toot the horn of Added Color enough, man. Doing great things, man. Check them out, please. That being said, I will end these episodes like I always do by, again, reminding you guys to like and follow PodScum on Facebook, like, subscribe, hit the notification bell on this channel, and always remember to take it easy and keep it sleazy.